This is Henk Akkermans, and this is Smart Asset Management Lecture 5, Section 3, Designing a Maintenance Program, Part 2. So, in Part 1, we saw already the different steps that are needed to design a maintenance program, and that in Section 1 we look mostly on the FMEA, the failure mechanisms that you need to identify of the asset before you actually can take the next step, which is to select the appropriate maintenance actions then to prevent those failures. And that's where we zoom in this section. So choosing such a maintenance policy is straight enough in theory, but complicated in practice. In theory, there are only two ways, either you're reactive or you're proactive. And when you're reactive, that means that you fix failures after they occurred. When you're proactive, there are different ways of doing that. You can do it every time, every certain fixed interval, every year, every month, or whatever interval you, or based on the usage, how many kilometers the car has driven, or how many flight hours the plane has had, or condition based, which is sort of our holy grail. You only do it when it's needed, because theoretically that's the more sophisticated approach. Failure based repair obviously is in general too late. Time based often turns out to be too early, and condition based is then just in time. In a separate section we'll move on, the lecture indeed we'll look at condition based maintenance. Now let's mainly look at those other types of maintenance, which are still by far the dominant ones in today's industries. So with planned maintenance, you plan maintenance ahead of time. And the aim is, of course, to prevent or at least postpone the moment of failure. In doing so, you make certain trade-offs. The later that you do the maintenance, the lower the planned maintenance cost, but of course the higher the corrective maintenance cost, because then equipment will have broken down and somewhere there's an optimum. And usually companies like to stay at the safe side, so relatively short intervals, because corrective maintenance often is quite expensive. But that means by definition that you leave some remaining useful life behind. A fully functional machine is repaired, as Hans Wachtmann describes this. And you have to be able to more or less say, well, it's probably going to happen then that this machine will break down, irrespective of your knowledge of the condition of the machine, of the train, of whatever asset we talk about. And of course, the preventive action has to make sense. It has to. There's quite a lot of unplanned breakdowns that occur as a result of well-meant maintenance activities, but still. And often, some kind of a mix is chosen. Now, for planned maintenance, then, the failure rate becomes key. So how high is the likelihood that a station, an asset, breaks down in some period, given that it's still up at the beginning? Those failure rates may go up and down. If they're pretty constant, then actually it doesn't really matter when you do the maintenance, because every time there's an equally high likelihood that failures will occur. If the failure rate is going up, then you want to be sure that you don't do the failure maintenance too late, because later on failure rates will go quickly. In the classical bathtub curve, there is some infant mortality, then a long time where it really is a flat, a constant failure rate, and towards the end of life things are going up. And that of course determines the choice for planned maintenance. So there is a dilemma. Hey, do I replace a well-functioning part just because it's time? How often do I do that? For what machines, what parts? And how do I estimate then these failure patterns, and perhaps should I do it for everything or not? Well, Roland van der Kerkhoff did a nice literature study on different types of investigations on degradation patterns, on failure patterns. And actually, the results are quite surprising to many, including to me, which is that this bathtub curve only happens in, well, let's say 4% of cases, and several studies confirm that. So this is really the exception rather than the rule, whereas most of the policies are based on the assumption of this increasing failure rate towards end of life. But indeed, there is a wear out pattern, which also includes, well, anywhere between, I don't know, 5 and 15%. There's fatigue where there's an increasing rate. So all in all, this may be from 10% to 30% of the cases, the dominant pattern, and then planned maintenance makes a lot of sense. But the other case is the slow ramp-up case, where actually most of the childhood diseases, the teething problems, have been taken out after very careful testing because it's very expensive and important equipment. The constant failure rate, which applies to much of the electronic equipment, you never know when it breaks down again. In those cases, actually, the period could also be infinite. So periods are then pretty arbitrary, looking at it from the logic of the machine. So corrective maintenance, should we say that's considered harmful, as Edgar Dijkstra once said, of go-to statement, so that's a bad thing to do? Well, it has cost, it's unplanned, as a breakdown, there may be safety issues, the machine may be broken, you lose availability that you didn't expect, there may be extra cost. But in many cases, still, it's unavoidable or acceptable that there is corrective maintenance. So if this happens, can you then do something to make the consequence at least less severe? Yeah, well, you can. When we talked about this in our discussion on 6S and OEMs, etc., you can at least become very good at corrective maintenance, a bit like the Formula One pit stop idea. You can have the maintenance be done by the operator themselves, autonomous maintenance. You can have the exchange of spares done by a single minute exchange of die, SMED principles, so really fast. So that means that, yes, the breakdown still occurs, but you recover from it very quickly. That will require excellent coordination between production and maintenance. In practice, all sorts of things occur. Take these two examples from Hans Wachtmann. This pump may be in a red condition, but it's in a line of pumps. So if I take this down now and I take out the whole line, that will not please the operations manager. Or here is a whole fleet, a series of, in principle, identical pumps, and only one of them is actually really red. So if I have to bring somebody in and have the tools and have the activity, couldn't I then take some of the others as well? A bit of opportunistic maintenance. Because that's what clustering often leads to, opportunistic maintenance. And that's not meant in a negative sense, but if the machine is down anyway, well, why not fix this? You then sacrifice some remaining useful life against the cost of actually doing the maintenance. And it can be quite beneficial from an economic policy. And of course, all sorts of combinations are possible. One extreme case of clustering is fleet management, where you have fleet is in Wachtmann's definition, not by definition number of cars or ships or planes, but anyway, a number of identical products. And these products have then two main important priorities. Because there's a lot of them, you can organize the maintenance of them as a flow, go one down, one down, one down. And that means that you have not the setup cost and the changeover cost that you have in other production activities. And of course, because they're identical, you can collect data over a larger number of instances and therefore can also, in terms of condition-based maintenance, develop better degradation models sooner. And of course, because it's multiple cases, that the data also becomes more reliable. A whole different question for a different lecture is then on what data and how do you use those data. So in benefits, actually, it's a great opportunity for improved design of a maintenance program. It gives you the sooner faster feedback, it allows flow production, good information systems. However, in practice, fleet management is much more complex than just this focus on indeed corrective versus preventive maintenance. We already saw in our discussion of the infrastructure at MIT and how to save a leaky ship that organizations may end up in a vicious spiral of lots of backlog and therefore only time to do the corrective maintenance and therefore even more corrective maintenance in the future. This study of bus management in intercity bus management in an Italian setting shows you the many interconnections. Yes, there is asset management there with buses in different ages. And there is the different types of backlog, but there is also the service provision of the bus that you need to have, and the staff of maintainers and all those financial consequences of those. So only somewhere here in the technical domain is the choice, should we do, what type of maintenance policy should we have? Many other factors also determine that. Another example is in the humanitarian operations. Here is fleet transport from a study done by Martin S. Stapleton and Luc van Wassenhoven on humanitarian operations. There, the humanitarian organization often buys those Land Rovers, etc., centrally, or they're donated or whatever, and then they're sent to specific countries, and in the countries they're being used, which means that some of the functions are done centrally and the other ones are done locally. What you then get is, as the author noticed, is that in these kind of models, well, at least half of the cost of the fleet is not optimized, because in the country, fleet management doesn't exist. It's done in solos. So that makes it's very difficult to do any optimization there. So because there are so many other factors than just the technical failure rate considerations that people have in how they want to do their maintenance. So asset portfolio management done primarily from basis of FMECAs and failure rates is wonderful, but in reality many other factors also apply, and it's even more so if the external environment is changing, as we'll see in the next section.